And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Monastery, the open bar of the internet, the world's greatest shit show, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this most holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, and most batshit ways possible. I am your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra, and with me I have some returning good friends into the temple. But in a rare change of pace, I am joined by my co-pilot. Some of you may have seen him in The Valley of the Judged. Some of you may have seen him in Geek Watch or the post trade show hangover specials that we've done. He is the man of a thousand runes, the CEO of Zadare Enterprises, and the bane of my fucking existence. Good brother Xanatrix.
I even get to bane him here.
and making his triumphant return, the creative director of Lost Lorn Games and the man behind the madness when it comes to the upcoming Badlander RPG, which we will be talking about, good brother Mark Reinhagen. How you doing
hello,
today?
Hello. How's everyone doing?
Good, now that I don't have to deal with time zone hell.
Sorry about that.
No worries. Believe me when I say I am more than used to messing around with time zones.
It's a little surreal for me to be here. This is my first time inside one of his interviews.
I had figured. I knew I wanted to do something interview related now that the Kickstarter is actually live, which is doing really damn well for itself because we're about over two thirds of the way done, and we still got it around over 20 days to go.
Yep.
And I was thinking, how can I do something different? The conversion thing, that's gonna take a little while. I'm still not finished with that script. But bringing him back in for another one, well, we'd be treading similar ground. And then the idea came to me. Oh, I know. I'll bring my brother in, and we'll have a bit more chaos.
I'm chaos incarnate. So this was nothing but good ideas. Mm-hmm. Nothing but good ideas.
And I didn't even have to pull it. I didn't even have to cosplay as Archimedes for having this great idea.
I mean, it's not much of a cosplay when you rip off all your clothing.
It is still a costume if it's a character.
I mean, even a naked cosplayer could be a cosplayer. Especially if you're, drawing on your skin.
Yeah, but Monk's not short enough.
Most what?
Monk's not short enough.
Okay.
He's too tall to be Archimedes.
Yeah, there is that problem.
And there's a more obvious problem, but I won't get into it.
Well, depending on the time of year, I wouldn't do that anyways because it'd be too damn cold.
Mm-hmm.
But how have you been holding up the last few months? I know we had the time zone confusion because I thought you were still in Georgia.
Yeah, I got COVID, finally. I've been so careful. Come to America and I catch COVID, but thankfully I got Paxlovid, which is like this miracle drug. I was not doing great, and I got Paxlovid, and boom, within like 4 days, I was way better. But yeah, boy, I kind of had in my head, oh, I'll be fine with COVID. No, hit me like a 10-ton truck. Boom. I was wiped out. Crazy.
Yeah, but I'm recovering.
Better now. I still have this lingering cough, but other than that, I'm fine. Mm-hmm.
And, well, when it comes to a cough, you can take all the medicine and get rid of it in a week, or take none of it and get rid of it in 7 days.
Yeah. Yeah. I figure there's not much I can do about a cough. Mm-hmm. So, I'm going the 7-day route.
Well, since I had dominated the interviews the last couple of times, Zan, I'll let you take charge for once.
Oh my, taking charge of your show. This is a. am I on candid camera?
No.
Oh. The inmates are running the asylum. Everyone,
I mean,
watch out.
I tend to do that anyway. All right, so I know that this is primarily the show about Badlander, so I'll start with when coming up with Badlander and looking into it, and like I said, before we started, I refreshed myself on everything we talked about in our review of the Quick Start. The mix of DNA between a lot of 5e and a lot of storyteller system games was very apparent, along with a glue you guys had actually meshed in that was original ideas. Which, if any, system did you really start with as the skeleton for Badlander?
Oh, definitely D&D. Basically, you know, the whole quote Willie Sutton made about, why do you rob banks? And he goes, well, that's where the money is. Well, right now in gaming, you know, the top game played is D&D. And then I think the second most played is like OSR, you know, which is Old School Renaissance, which is basically old school D&D. And then there's the D&D clones, and then there's Pathfinder, right? So basically, D20 is what the vast majority of people are familiar with. And so if you want to make a game, you need to sort of play into that a little bit at least. And so the idea is that we meet people where they start. And all these new players and people who've been playing, you know, since Stranger Things, you know, all these new players, you know, I think they're probably getting a little tired of some of the things in D&D. Not that D&D is bad. D&D is king. But there are some tricks and modern stuff that you can do that you know, you can find in Dungeon World or My Games, Vampire, storytelling tricks, narrative tricks, you know, realism tricks. Things that just sort of make the game better that people don't really have in D&D, and they're kind of trapped in that paradigm, you know, where it's, you know, hack and slash, go up in levels, and then of course you inevitably level out. You can't play your character anymore after like 7th or 8th level, right? Because it's just too powerful. I mean, everything's totally boring. So the idea was, can we take these bones that everyone knows so well and sort of add in and warp, change this into like a modern style storytelling game that lets people really dig into their characters, that doesn't get ruined when you go up in levels, that still works. You can still play a 14th or 15th level campaign, you know, easily. And so I think that's what we did, you know. And then by combining like the dots, you know, of the storyteller system, which obviously some D&D players are going to think is terrible, but the reason for it is that, you know, I've always noticed that, you know, a good 1/3 of role players are scared of math, you know, and a half of people in the world are scared of math and hate math. Now, I love math. I think math is really awesome and fun, and I, you know, I'm really keen on my kids being good at math, but I think it's wonderful, you know, how I fell in love with math through gaming. But people who see a bunch of numbers on a piece of paper get scared off and don't play role playing games. So the original reason why I did dots with storyteller system and now with this is so that people look at the page and there's very few numbers on it, and so it's not scary, or at least it's less scary.
All right. We here at the monastery, I'm sure Monk has told you, have our own issues with the world's most ubiquitous game, as we call it.
Yeah.
And I can really see how you've taken the time to address, like you said, those systems that may not be doing so well, and those features that may be tiring to players. And it's really, really nice that you address those with pieces of the storyteller system, and also with those original pieces that you've put in that I also made comparisons to other games with, because having a wide breadth of knowledge then allows me to make those comparisons. And with the dots, I see that you have five dots and then you strike through for a sixth.
Yeah.
And
I was one to do that in earlier on, and everyone was like, no, that's dumb. So this time I'm like, I'm for sure doing the strike through. Because also D&D, you know, if you look at the proficiency bonuses, it does go up to six. So that's the way in which I did it. And some people in our company want us to have six dots, but do you know why I didn't go to six dots? I did the strike through instead.
What is that?
Is that psychologically the human eye is able to pick up five instantly without thinking. Six, your eye starts getting confused and you have to start counting the dots. And the whole point is not to have to count the dots. You just look at the dots, you know how many dots there are. That's it.
Okay. That makes sense. I remember playing some of the older storyteller games like Vampire or Mage, and when people started getting to elder level powers, because sometimes our storytellers were insane, especially when they allowed me to play a mage, because I broke the game every time. Once you start getting above five dots and powers, yeah, you started, your counting started becoming a little more laborious. So that strike through is actually pretty ingenious, I'll say.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I was always against adding the more dots, but you know, of course, people always want to, you know, it's like that Spinal Tap. Yeah, my amp goes up to 11, right? People always want to go higher.
They want to push the envelope. Yeah.
If you're going to be bringing up Spinal Tap, then I have to request one thing. If you have a black book version of Badlander, have somebody hold it up and just go, "How much more black can this book get?" And the answer is none. None more black.
So now my next question is regarding specifically the drama stones. Where did you guys get the idea for that communal, like, role play solution reward system?
I mean, I've been playing around with the idea of, you know, how to do advantage or how to give people, you know, bonus points. And there's so many games that do it in different ways. And so I always have some house rule system where I do something like that. And what I did is I said, okay, if this is a board game, how would I do it? And I would go, well, first of all, as a board game, it would be a communal board game, right? It would be a cooperative board game. Mm-hmm. And so by having these stones be held in common, it kind of adds more drama, because then you're arguing with yourselves and blah, blah, blah. But a player in their turn can use a stone if they want to, and no one can stop them, right? So it's only peer pressure. No, don't do that. And the person goes, it's my turn. I'm going to use the stone, but I could die next turn. I'll need the stone. No, you can't. And then it becomes this whole dramatic thing. And then by tying them into experience points, that's what I'm super proud of, really, really proud of, because I love push your luck. And so now the game system is that you need to click the end of the game session, whatever drama stones you have left over, that's your communal hit experience points. And you collect them. And when you get a certain amount, you don't know how many, only the tail spinner knows, you go up the next rank. We don't have levels, we have ranks. You go to the next rank. And so you want to collect these drama stones, but yet you also want to use them so you don't die. You know, so you can, or you can succeed. And so it becomes this this painful thing where some players are screaming, don't use the drama stone. And other ones are like, power up, power it up, power it up. You know, and I love that tension in a game. I think that's what as a game designer and as a tail spinner, that's what I'm always looking for. I'm looking for the players that have these raucous arguments and these big cheers and these moments of exaltation, these moments of depression. That's what is really memorable about a gaming session.
Absolutely. I can definitely see how the drama stones would play into that. And also because of the sidebar that we saw in the starting materials and how the drama stones work, it definitely rewards and encourages people to learn how to roleplay effectively. So you've tied in not only the emotional roller coaster that is gaming into a level up platform as well, but also tied in encouragement and incentive for role playing itself, which can only encourage people to learn that particular art, because role playing is different than acting in many cases, simply because you're not just taking on the role. You do have to embody your character a little bit at the very least to be effective. So it's I guess you could say it's like method acting, but even that comparison falls a little flat in my opinion. The one comparison I did make with drama stones and the fact that they're tied into experience was it's almost similar to the Ki system from Tenra Bansho Zero, where in that system players reward each other these little Ki chits, and then they have to do a different taxing, literally taxation. You have to calculate how much karma you got and make sure you don't go over, and there's a bunch of different facets there. But I really liked that it was still tied into the performance, and I only think that can improve a session.
I'm really happy with that, and also I like how they tie into the seven passion pairs. Because that one thing that tends to be lacking in all role playing games, including mine, is that people don't tend to play their emotions. And if you know anyone who knows humans knows that we live most of our lives very emotionally, especially when you're around family. You're reminded of this, or you know, old time friends, or you know, there's a lot of emotions going around. But yet, characters are like these perfectly rational actors, right? In any situation, they're not doing things emotionally. But now with the drama stones being so important, not only for your survival and your success, but you're being able to level up, right? Well, role-playing out a negative emotion is probably a really good idea, you know? And you hope that it's recognized and you get the point. You get the stone. And so at least in my playtest, people were hamming it up a bit. And honestly, it was really fun. Like, having people ham up their emotions and play it, sure, sometimes it was silly, but a lot of times it actually led to some really powerful moments. And it was fantastic. And, you know, because one emotion tends to build another emotion and have a counter emotion. And it was just sort of like, it just felt, it was just a very unique experience for me.
And, you know, that is a good point, the passion pairs. It's definitely a better take on alignment or any of those particular mechanics we see in other RPGs in comparison, because this gives you multiple things to act out on, both in a positive and negative manner. And instead of just giving you two descriptive words that tell you how your general demeanor is supposed to be, and it's definitely better for that sort of guidance on, well, how are you going to roleplay your character? Well, you chose the pairs. Chose the pairs, all of them, both your three virtue pairs, your three vice pairs, and your crux pair. You know exactly how your character is supposed to play because you picked them. That's fantastic. That is
clear guidance on behavior, right?
Yeah. Yeah,
you know, like it's pretty darn clear, and what I love also is that even though like you may be very courageous, you know, at a drop of a hat you could flip, and your very strong courage can turn into very strong cowardice, because I think the pairs if they're high, they're both high, and now one is more dominant, but if something happens where suddenly get scared. There's no one gets more scared than a person who's been brave all their life, right? Mm-hmm. You know, or who's been brave the entire battle. If they suddenly get scared, that's the person who's going to start running for the hills, you know? And I think it captures some truth about the human condition that that I think is very interesting, and you see it a lot in storytelling and fiction, you know.
Absolutely, that sort of crisis of self is definitely something that happens in fiction, and even as more broadly, if we're going to bring in literature, the hero's journey, the monomyth, that happens even there. So it's definitely a fantastic way to play up your strengths and also play up your weaknesses and see how they can flip if the situation aligns that way. I definitely enjoy the virtues.
Mm-hmm. And the yeah, bio. Thank you. I'm very keen on it as well. I think it's one of the more innovative personality alignment systems done. So, and we're going to keep doing it in the subsequent games. So Fang Knight, we're going to keep that system, but do it in a slightly different way and tie it into the vampire stuff. So each game will have the same passions and each game will have blight. You know, like with the World of Darkness games, you kind of switch them out more. So in this system, we want people to be able to play that, you know, each player play a character from a different game and they can still play in a group together, right? And they're still balanced. And so that all the seven games all tie together tightly into one metagame. But that doesn't mean we can't make Blight work differently in each game or the passions work differently. So we can explore different areas. And so the passions for the vampires will be very different and actually, you know, control their uncanny and their rights in a weird way. And when they drink the blood of someone who has a strong passions, they can then get caught up in those passions themselves. So that blood holds the passions and they can be sent out of whack by drinking certain kinds of blood of someone with a strong passion.
Mm-hmm. That actually answers one of the questions we had during our quick start review. We wondered if everything was going to be in a shared universe, just like the World of Darkness games had been.
Well, World of Darkness games tried, but depending on what entries you were using, trying to have them in a shared universe could create problems.
Don't mix with mage. Never mix with mage.
Yeah. It just got out of hand. And so basically this time I said, well, this time I'm not letting it get out of hand. I'm going to keep very tight control. And you can do new things. But the idea is you can play any of these games. You can play a character from one of these games in any other game. And you can mix and match all you want. And it'll be really fun. Because that's sort of the whole thing with D&D, you know, is you can kind of mix and match. And the difference is that in D&D, tonally and thematically, it doesn't really make sense that you have a samurai and this ninja mixing it up with a Egyptian character and a Norse character, berserker. And you know what I mean? It's just too weird. But in this case, we're going to have, you know, mixing up vampires and werewolves and ghosts and all that together in one fantasy world. Hey, that works, you know? Like having a ghost character in your gaming group, I think would be freaking awesome. Like I would watch that movie. Like there's literally a ghost walking along with your group. I think that's cool.
There's been
plenty. That's what we're going for.
There's been plenty of characters.
Step one.
There's been plenty of characters throughout fantasy who are either a ghost or undead or something like that, and make frequent tongue-in-cheek jokes about that. And the first thing that comes to mind when it comes to that sort of thing is the insanity that happens in Terry Pratchett's work.
Yeah.
You know, where Death himself has a interesting outlook and sense of humor.
Yeah. I'm a big Discworld fan. It's amazing.
I'd be remiss if I didn't bring up the whole thing of him giving a kid a sword.
Yeah.
What if she cuts herself? That will be an important
lesson.
And of course, but one of the one of their One thing that I was curious about, since we've mentioned this this shared setting approach. Now, I think the obvious part is that it is that we're still leaning in that Renaissance adjacent fantasy throughout Badlander and what will come later. But when it came to the supernatural system with that alignment setup that we covered in our Valley on the Quick Start, is that going to be called to in the other books as well?
Is what going to be called to?
The seven virtues and vials. He already said they were going to.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. All of that continues on. The seven Dwemer, the seven virtues and vials, the seven vile moons. Everything is part of Lostlorn. This is part of the deep setting of Lostlorn. Mm-hmm. And we're just going to keep pushing that out. Like, all of that is part of the world. And it's all just become more and more rich and more and more explained and more deep.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's all, everything is designed. Like, I think that's one problem with a lot of role-playing games is they try to sort of be open to any world, right? And therefore they just sort of are bland because they're not set in one world. And so what we're doing is everything is very clearly, absolutely set in Lostlorn. Now, that doesn't mean you can't take our vampire rules or our Badlander rules and apply and use them in your game. In fact, we designed everything to be modular, so you can take any rule section you want, any power you want, any character class, race, whatever, and you can use it in your D&D campaign. It's no problem, right? But then that's up to you to make it work, right? But in terms of Lostlorn, we're going to make everything work just perfectly with that and be this bespoke, unique world where everything just works really well together.
And in that vein, something that I was a bit curious about, because a lot of times when you have a game that is dipping into that large of a world, it'll get segmented in individual books. A good example of this would be the Fantasy Flight Games run with Warhammer 40K, where each of the books, Dark Heresy, Black Crusade, Death Watch, Only War, and Rogue Trader, were each occupying a different region of space within their book. Are you considering doing that with Badlander, where the Badlander book specifically focuses on one region in the Lostlorn setting?
No. Badlanders are, they do tend to work for the crown of each kingdom, and so they're like the royal bodyguards and special forces, essentially. Mm-hmm. But as special forces and as the sort of the scouts and the mappers and the frontiers people, they do tend to go to the edges and boundaries of the kingdom. So, they go on these missions. So they can pretty much go anywhere. But like socially, yeah, they have a very unique place because they basically go back and forth between court and then sort of the common folk, the frontiers folk of the borderlands, mm-hmm. So whereas if you play Fang Knight, the vampires are considered to be knights and the higher rank ones, lords, and they have their own castle, this Firehold, which sits over a hellhole, which leads into the Abysma, this giant sort of dungeon world that eventually leads to the Inferno Hell, mm-hmm. right? And so what they tend to do is they tend to go down. And Badlanders don't really go into the Abysma as much as the Fang Knights do. So the Fang Knights will be a bit more of a dungeon crawl. But hey, if you want to bring your Badlanders into an Abysma and do a giant-ass dungeon crawl, it's no problem. You can do that.
Great. Now you're giving people ideas to do that with Tomb of Horrors, which I hope you know what you're doing.
Yeah.
Breaking out fucking Tomb of Horrors. But I would like to dip into the Crux Dice.
Yes, one of my favorite things.
How did this particular thing come about? Because I was getting flashbacks to the escalation die in 13th Age. I think I
absolutely
that.
that's where the idea came from. Is that I liked the escalation die, but I thought it was a little bit too one dimensional. And I was like, yeah. And so I started using it in my playtest just because I hate long combat, you know? Like, I really hate long combat. I really don't like the D&D combat that goes on. You know, if a combat lasts more than 40 minutes, I'm going to get bored, right? I just don't find it interesting, and I don't like waiting for other people's turns. So I'm really into the old school Renaissance style where, you know, you have group initiative and you all go at once and you're arguing and yelling and everyone rolls the dice at once and it's just fast, you know? And we'll be doing that, by the way, in Fang Knight. In Badlander, we have a different initiative system. But anyway, the Crux dice were just... I was just using escalation dice for 13th Age to make things feel more and more risky and make it so people wanted to get the combat over fast. And then one day I went, wait a minute, why don't I just have two different dice for each side, and that's your morale. And so this adds to your rolls, and then you can and it helps you. And then once someone goes above 6 on the dice, the other side has to basically make a morale roll, mm-hmm. you know, and that's basically how it is. And so it's a really flexible, cool system, and we're expanding that. For instance, in Fang Knight, whichever side goes first in the turn is whatever side has the highest crux dice. Mm-hmm. That literally is your initiative, your group initiative. So if you gain enough crux points in the turn where you can take the crux away, you could have basically two turns in a row. You went last this turn, this round. Well, next round you go first. That's two in a row. That's enough to devastate someone. And then you can still make them surrender or retreat by having to make a morale roll. So I think the crux dice are really fun. And they're very, very simple. You just have this giant dice. I have a giant dice as the tail spinner for my bad guys, and the players have this giant D6 for them, and you're just seeing it go up. And the higher it goes up, the more kind of dangerous everything is, the more wild everything is.
Mm-hmm. And speaking of dangerous and wild, let's talk about initiative, because the approach that we have with initiative is one that I haven't seen in quite a while.
Maybe ever.
Oh,
I've never seen it before. Is it? Have you seen it before?
I've seen something close, but given that it's me, that's not that. Take that with a grain of salt, because I am an absolute freak when it comes to the amount of rule sets that are in my head. As Zan can attest, I have. If you were to count all the PDFs that I have, you could not count that high. I'll put it like that.
Wow. Okay. Well, you need to be in the Fang Knight group then, because we're discussing mechanics right now. You'd be really useful in there.
He might, except we're already designing our own game, and
okay.
We're kind of involved in that like every Monday.
Yeah.
That we can.
I appreciate the offer though, and I might consider it. I just have to make sure I'm not juggling too many plates, or spinning too many plates while Saber Dance is playing in the background.
Totally understand.
But for the benefit of those who didn't see the Valley episode, what I'm referring to is the fact that initiative is essentially a bidding war, almost like you're playing Texas Hold'em with your initiative score. And That's the way I interpreted it. I'm not sure if that was the intent.
You compared it to another game where you said it was like blackjack and this was Texas Hold'em.
I've jokingly referred to Hang on, I'm getting echo from somebody. But I had said that, because I've said that Fading Suns, which is a very fascinating game in its own right, and up until recently was the closest thing we could get to a Dune RPG without breaking the damn bank. I've called D20 Blackjack. And the reason I called it that is because its core mechanic, the victory point system, is a roll under D20 system, but you're trying to get as close to the target to under the target number as you can, because the closer you are to the target number without going over, the more victory points, i.e. degrees of success that you get. And with the initiative system that we saw with Badlander, I made the comparison to Texas Hold'em because everybody's hiding their initiative and everybody's waiting for somebody to make the first mistake. And
yes,
it very much reminded me of how in a game of Texas Hold'em, everybody's playing mind games with each other to see who's going to call someone's bluff.
Yes. And whoever makes the first mistake loses, essentially. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm a big fan of Texas Hold'em, and I love games that have that mind fuckery part of my French in them. You know,
you don't need to limit your French here in the monastery. Everything is on the table.
And so I'm really happy with that initiative system. But to be honest, we're changing it in Fang Knight, and that doesn't mean we're going to change it later in Badlander, because basically we want to have each game have a slightly different system, and then you can pick which one you want, you know? And so this system is really great, but it takes slightly more time. And in Fang Knight, it's just going to be your Crux Dice determines who goes first, and it's a group initiative, just like in a lot of old school Renaissance games. And it's just much more chaotic and fun, and combat will be even faster.
Yeah.
But this initiative system where you choose your D20 and you're holding it, you're hiding it, and you're sort of choosing a number below your initiative shield number. I think it's pretty fun, pretty fast, and it kind of lets you sort of play games on when you're going to go, and it's fairly fast, even so, and because you don't have to roll, you're basically choosing. I think it's really interesting, and I'm pretty much planning right now on keeping it, you know, for, you know, Badlander forever, because I think it works for Badlander. Just that, you know, when we do Vampire, and you know, I think it should be even more storytelling and fast, and in Fang Knight, you're going to have playing wizards, but you're going to play them with your knaves, your guards, basically. So there'll be a bunch of guards and fighting and, you know, it'd be very dungeon crawl sort of thing, protecting. That's what we're trying to protect their vampires. So in that thing, I think we want a really even faster, more old school Renaissance feel to it. So we'll just go with a slightly different initiative system. That's all.
Go ahead, Sam.
When you brought up Dune in reference to the other RPG, I actually remembered that I had made the point that part of your setting is just Dune. Ortho is the spice melange.
there's seven flavors of it though.
Yes,
so for one for each Dwemer, so it actually each are very very different. There's actually seven different types of spice, so it like has and they're profoundly different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the point was that it's a reality shaping substance that you can use to change the fabric of reality, and if you use too much of it, you become a twisted, mutated horror beyond comprehension. Just look at the Navigators and the Navigators Guild for Dune. It's the spice melange.
Yeah. It actually has its origins in my first role playing game was Ars Magica, and we had Vis in Latin. You spell a V as a W, so it's Vis, V-I-S, and that was raw magic, and a lot of their magic was based on that. And I was always really proud of that idea, and always thought, well, why haven't more games taken that and run with it? And I go, since Ars Magica hasn't really been out there. And I was like, I'm going to take it. But yeah, it's been so long. You know, it's been the 80s since I first wrote Ars Magica. Probably it was inspired by Dune. I was a huge Dune kid. There's no doubt.
And
hey, there are worse things you could have pulled.
Yeah, no, I was more of a Dune. I loved Lord of the Rings. Don't get me wrong. The Hobbit, especially when I was very young, was like my favorite kid book, you know. And I love the Lord of the Rings, but definitely Dune was my go-to love of my life as a teenager, you know.
Mm-hmm. I think I've mentioned this in the past, but I have a complicated history when it comes to the Lord of the Rings. Not because of any dislike for the books or anything like that, but more the fact that I've always been annoyed with how limited people's view of fantasy is. And specifically this idea that you have to do that very Western European British Isles aesthetic in order for it to be considered fantasy.
I mean if Tolkien wasn't so universally loved and copied and redone again and again and stolen from, it would be way better shit, right? But it's just been stolen from so much, and people are so completely obsessed with it that it just affects everything around it. And so you get tired of it because, you know, it's just copied so much. You know, it's like for me, it's like fast food, right? Like, there's nothing wrong with a hamburger. I love a good hamburger. I love hamburger and fries and a shake. That's like the ideal meal. But every single fast food restaurant just about has that. And it's boring. And, you know, I guess I could eat it once a week, maybe. But any more than that, I'm like, ugh. And I just see my kids eat it, like, order a hamburger. I'm like, what are you doing? Like, there's so much other food you can order. Order something else. And they're kids, and they just want hamburger and fries.
Granted, I wasn't still am addicted to pasta, so I'm not one to talk. But
there's a thousand ways to make pasta.
For what it's worth, if something else was at that same level of Lord of the Rings, I would have the same problem, because the issue really is this idea of what we here in the temple call design by gospel.
Yeah.
And since and Zan, would you mind being the evangelist when it comes to giving the skinny on what we mean when we refer to design by gospel?
Of course. I never mind being the evangelist. You know this, Monk. There's a reason Brother Joel named me that. Mm-hmm. So essentially, design by gospel is the idea that something must be designed in a specific way in order for it to be evoking the namesake of its design. You are designing it that way because it has always been designed that way, and thus must always be designed that way. Tradition for tradition's sake, there's a lot of different ways to say it. Essentially, you aren't designing the game in a way that is conducive to the way you want the game to play, because that is how you see it achieving its goal. You're designing the game in a way that pays homage to what it's always been. And there are plenty of examples. The most ubiquitous game actually has a lot of this problem, which is, again, one of the many different gripes we have with it.
Yeah, but, and there are artifacts in the 5th edition which are insane.
Oh, like, we've covered a lot of those.
Uses newbies so much is that your spell levels don't relate to your character levels. They're different.
What's funny about that is
people always get confused by that, and they fixed that in 4th edition.
Oh yeah, the edition everybody tells me I'm
so angry at them doing that in 4th edition. Yeah. Excuse me. They changed it back because the fans insisted on it, even though every newbie is always instantly confused. Like, wait a minute, I'm 5th level. Why can't I do 5th level spells? Mm-hmm. You know? And it's all because, well, that's just how it's always been done, and so that's how we have to keep doing it.
Yeah. And as far as demanding it to be turned back, something that Zan and I have discussed in the past is that Sometimes when people ask for something, they don't know what they ask for.
Yes, yes. Like, for instance, when people ask for more powerful characters, and they ask for death saves and hit dice and ways to not die, they think they're doing themselves a favor. They think that's going to make a better game for themselves. They think that that's going to give them a better experience, because then, oh, their character doesn't die. But wait a minute, they don't realize what any good game master or game designer will tell you is that if there's no fear of dying, if there's no fear of loss or any kind of setback, you're going to start having a really boring time. It'd be like a cooperative board game that you never lose, or a competitive board game in which no one ever won. Right? Like, it'd be pointless. It's absolutely pointless. Killer DMs are good, but you definitely need some character death, mm-hmm. and that simply does not exist in 5e. The number of characters who die in 5e is close to zero.
On the same end, I do think that doing rampant character death would be swinging the pendulum too far the other way. That's why I always bring up
absolutely. And so what you do is we have the blight system, mm-hmm. so that every time you go to zero, you get a blight point, and once you get to above 10 blight points, you're out. Your character is no longer a paraplegic character. And every time you get a blight point, you have these horrible things happen to you, either psychological blight or physical blight. And so, mm-hmm. you know, you can feel your character wearing down. Mm-hmm. And so it has a very real consequences. And so it's not just like, oh, I can live forever and, you know, be killed 1,000 times. No, every single time you're going to get a blight and you're screwed. And so you basically have 10 lives, you know, and mm-hmm. so it's a very, and each time you lose gain a blight point, it's a very real, disturbing thing. Mm-hmm. And you're going to have some real injury that actually has a consequence. And so I think that's hopefully will make things more real. And we're just going to double down on that in Vampire, because, of course, you know, in my other Vampire game with Humanity.
Yeah.
You know, we're just going to double down on that even more. And then the knaves, the warriors who protect you, they're all going to be maimed and injured and just full of, you know, just basically a ragtag bunch, because, you know, they're so worn down from fighting.
Things are dark in the lands of Lost Lorne, eh?
Yeah, I mean, because I don't want to kill characters off, but I definitely want to have players be afraid, mm-hmm. right? I want players to be afraid and cautious, and feel like there's something at risk, and that's why I like grimdark. That's why I like horror. Is that in a horror storytelling, it works very well for role playing, because it gets players to care. Yeah. Right, and so, like, if you had to ask my favorite movie style, it wouldn't be horror. You know, I'm not a huge horror movie person. I like horror movies, but I probably like, you know, don't kill me, but I love romantic comedies. It's like popcorn for me, you know.
Rom-coms can be fun.
Comedy. I love comedy movies most. Like Animal House and Blues Brothers are like my two favorite movies of all time.
Hey, Monk, we're on a mission from God.
So, but in a role-playing game, that horror element, that grimdark element, that element of, like, of peril, of blight, you know, of having your life force sucked away inch by inch, it just works.
It does. You know?
And it helps counteract the idea that, oh, yeah, the game master's not going to let any of us die, because then that's going to ruin the story, which is kind of true, you know? But if you force my hand, if you really lose all your... if you really go above 10 blight, yeah, you're out, you know?
Roll
but
somebody new.
Because they've seen it coming.
Anybody who says that the GM won't let the players die has never played Paranoia.
Wait, we can't tell him about that. Yeah. Is he at ultraviolet clearance?
Paranoia is genius.
I own it, so yeah. One thing I do have to do, actually, Monk, I have to shill Brother Tanner's game, Heavens and Heresies, because with the idea of death, as you said, Tanner makes it very hard for characters to die, but there is still the chance, and because of that, he's also given characters a way to make their deaths meaningful. It's literally a mechanic called raising the death flag, and if you use it at a perilous moment, it's that thing you have to do it, or everybody else is going to go down. You're going to get a TPK, and the you get super powerful because of it. You've raised the death flag. Your character is dying at the end of the encounter. Full stop. Not going to ever be reversed by anything, resurrection spells, whatever, which are rare enough in his world anyway. But the consequences, not only does your character die, when you roll up a new character, it has to have a different ancestry and a different class.
Wow.
Yeah.
So it's the ultimate sacrifice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Things are going tits up. You're having trouble. Everybody's struggling. You know that if you pop the death flag, you can save everybody, get them out of the perilous situation. It gives you that moment of role, like it's one of those ultimate role playing moments that everybody, I'm sure, has fantasized about at one point. The moment of, I gotta be the martyr, because if I don't, everybody dies. I gotta be that guy who does the heroic sacrifice. Mm-hmm. And it's like I said, I have to shill Heavens and Heresies every time I talk about anything 5e tangential.
Yeah, it's a good idea. I may steal it.
You hear that, Tanner? Your idea now is being used by might be used by Lost Lorn Games.
Yeah, it's a great thing about game rules. It's like fashion. You can't protect it. So we're free to borrow from each other always, which I'm always more than willing to learn from other games. Yeah, mm-hmm. That's how we push things forward. I just wish that D&D was changing more quickly than not, but because it's so popular and has so many people play it as it is, you know, it's gonna be very hard for them for the 5.5 coming up to do a good job.
The 5.5 is gonna start a civil war.
I have a feeling. Yeah,
because
five is pretty popular. So how are they gonna change things without pissing people off? Well, they can't.
And I've jokingly said that the more interesting stuff always happens in the third party, anyways, because of the fact that they aren't limited by those traditions. And because of that lack of a tradition issue, you don't end up running into some of the class design traps that Zan and I have discussed at length. One of the big ones being certain archetypes being way too useful and certain archetypes being useless, like say rangers.
Rangers are useless. Clerics are too useful. They've been too useful since 3.
We've used a term that unfortunately we didn't come up with, but it is still applicable. In the up until 3rd edition, we called it Codzilla. Cod being short for cleric or druid, because somebody who knows what they're doing with either of those classes or both of those classes is an entire party all by themselves. And in 5th edition, we shifted it to Cowzilla, because druids can still be powerful, but in terms of the whole party by themselves, that's clerics and warlocks.
In short, we used to be pescatarians, but now we're entirely just land-based carnivores.
Well, this is why we, sorry to go back to Badlander, but that's why we sort of redid all the races and the guilds, which are our classes, is that first of all, the guilds are real world, so you can't really talk about my character is in the fight. It's a fighter class. Class isn't really a world thing, right? But a guild is. And then we gave them very different powers and different sort of archetypes, so they're familiar. Like Duskwatch, obviously, is rogue. and Avowed are obviously cleric, but they're different. They have their different qualities to them, and I think they're much better balanced.
Yeah.
So it'll be something that makes players not as bound to, you know, these frames of reference and ancient arguments over what's more powerful, and you know, and this gate style of play, which is entirely player power based, you know, like I ideally you want your players not to look on their sheet for their next action, but be listening to your description and do an action based on your description, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the problem with 5e play is that everyone's actions tend to be based on what powers are written on their character sheet.
And what I find interesting with that is the emphasis on disciplines as the big stick of what you're going to be getting as you develop. Because I've jokingly said that the way 5e is designed is deathly afraid of character personalization. And
it doesn't like you to customize anything, I swear.
Unless you're a caster where you're going to be picking your spells, but low bar. But in a lot of cases, your customization begins and ends with your class and your subclass, and maybe feats, but having feats be a alternative for ASI was something I was not a fan of when I first heard of it, and I am still not a fan of it. At least in that sense, because you're only getting four feats as a. I know that with what we've seen with Badlander, you are doing the you can pick between ASI or a feat, but there's more opportunities to do it over the levels.
Yeah. Yeah, and also we basically allow multi-classing, not by you literally can't be in more than one guild, but we have these sub guilds. Which you have at the adept level, which is basically your ranks 1 through 10, and your master level, which is your essentially your level 11 through 20, but for us it's master rank 1 through 10. And so then you can sort of join other guilds' sub-factions. So and that's sort of how we're doing it. And that way it has a storytelling sort of rhyme and reason, and it lets you do some mix and matching and some various things. And it's I think it's much more creative and open ended than D&D tends to be, where you know they do have, which I understand they have this obsession with game balance, which and that's why they do it that way, is that their fan base will revolt if one player is too powerful, you know, and our philosophy is that well obviously some game masters aren't really in control of their game, and they'll let things go out of control, but for the most part. Our Tailspinners, which is our game master, are going to be able to control things very easily. We give them all these tools to do so, and it should be a problem, you know?
And I like that you point that out about game balance, because as much as D&D has tried to continue to keep game balance, as we've already pointed out with COD and Cowzilla, there are still characters that can monopolize game time. And that's not just the clerics or the warlocks or the druids, though they're the best at it. Most casters monopolize game time in the world.
I think Tanner put it best with what he said on the matter.
They get more game out of the game, yeah.
Yeah.
Which is why I really liked this new seventh attribute, Uncanny, and the fact that everything that is seemingly magical is all behind that one attribute.
Yeah, that is your key attribute. If you want to be that kind of person, then take that. Yeah, and then you can't take other ones. So, yeah, a seventh attribute tends to break it to help with the math as well. Like it's one more thing to have to worry about, you know?
Mm-hmm.
What's also true about Badlander, which people don't seem to realize a whole lot, is we don't have spellcasters in it.
Yeah,
like,
everybody.
Like, the sisters are close in that they're telling stories, and then they use the stories to shape reality, but there's no actual people casting spells.
I told you, Monk. I told you during the review that the spinsters are goddamn reality warpers.
Yeah.
I told you.
Yeah. Well, of course. I mean, we're all storytellers, right? We're all telling, we're all practicing the ancient art of storytelling around the campfire, basically. So, yeah, of course, I'm going to make the most powerful and the coolest guild to be the storytellers, be the ones who are, you know, shifting and shaping reality.
I think
that was never in doubt.
Yeah. I think my favorite descriptor when you have those little blurbs about each guild was for the spinsters was Troth Unraveler. It's like, yes, unravel the truth with your words. This is excellent. I love it.
You were thinking of Spider Jerusalem.
No, not entirely.
I'm also really proud of the Herald as a character, as a guild, as a class. Because I think that's something that's long been undone in games, is the person who can just talk your way out of situations. And because we have these crux rules, and they're so important, that allows us to have a guild that basically are talkers. But even during the combat, they're useful because they can help you win crux and win the battle without, you know, having to, you know, have it. The Herald can convince the other side to surrender or run away. You know, and that's really, really useful.
I love that.
And the great thing about, by the way, having someone surrender is that means you can ransom them, which is a huge thing in history that we tend to forget about. It's not really done in role-playing.
Knights ransoming other knights, yeah.
Yeah, like ransoming has been, it's always big in many cultures. And it's why you don't kill your enemies, is that they're worth more to you alive than dead. And that's why the Mongols were so feared, is the Mongols are like, yeah, we don't care. We're just going to get your gold later anyway. We're going to keep conquering. So let's just kill everyone. And that's why, you know, of course, Genghis Khan, by killing 40 million people, was the greatest mass killer in history. You know?
Yeah.
But that was an aberration. Like ransom was always the standard.
And you don't just ransom away a person either. Traditionally, you'd ransom a knight back to his family because he's at some level a noble, but then you'd ransom back his armor and his horse to him.
Yeah. and it became so honor bound that in both Japan and Europe and the Middle East, that if someone was renowned enough for having honor, which is, by the way, one of our passions, they would just be allowed to go home on their own recognizance, mm-hmm. and send back the ransom. They were considered to be person of such honor that you could just let them go home, and they'd send you the ransom.
Rare, but it did happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it did happen. Yeah, yeah. Or they would just take them back to your castle. You would go, okay, well, if you. We'll let you go back to my castle and surrender to my wife, and you'll stay there. You know? Of course, and if they didn't do what you said, then their name would be ruined and their life would be forfeit. At that point, they would never, ever be ransomed again. So they could never basically leave home. Yeah. So, yeah, it was a big deal.
Now, something I'm a bit curious about... is in regard to the birthrights, your equivalent to races. Since we mentioned Heavens and Heresies, I'd be remiss if I didn't point out that while that game uses ancestries instead of races for its own reasons, it isn't what it's a case where the impact of your choice of ancestry is a big damn deal in H&H, and in a lot of games that use race, ancestry, or whatever you want to call it, it matters early on, but late game it doesn't matter as much because all that it is just a few numbers changing and maybe an ability if you're lucky.
Yeah.
How much of an impact does Birthright have in Badlander?
Well, this is why we have not only for your Birthright, but your branch, which is your subgroup within it. Mm-hmm. For both of those, you have an edge, and that edge is divided into two. There's one edge for when you're an adept, and there's another edge for when you're a master. Mm-hmm. So when you become a master rank in your guild, then for your birthright and your branch, the specific version of that birthright, you get an additional power. Mm-hmm. And that power is big enough so that in late game, then suddenly that's really valuable and important. Mm-hmm. And you get that at 10th level, basically, at first level master, or 11th level, first mm-hmm. level master. So that I think that creates a texture that, you know, first of all makes, you know, like, oh, yeah, so NPCs who are high rank are scary. They have these extra powers, but I think it also makes it feel more real and more vital and more important. Mm-hmm. Because what's the point of having race if it doesn't affect anything after third level, right?
Yeah. You know? And I should note, actually, Zan, I'll let you take this when it comes to how big of a deal Ancestry is in H&H.
So in Heavens and Heresies, your Ancestry gives you your stat array, your HP, your various attribute defenses. It gives you it gives you your size, obviously, but it also gives you other things like different types of racial feats that can give you specific advantages in various areas, and also determines it determines half of character creation, because as part of Ancestries you also choose a background and an upbringing. The background gives you each background, it's laborers, warriors, nobles, and artisans. Each one gives you a different type of advantage you can get, whether it's getting skill proficiency or getting extra fighting acumen. And then you also have the upbringing, which can be physically, mentally, or balanced, and that helps raise some of your stats at the beginning of the game. The whole thing about Ancestries really affects the character build massively. And it's really fun to see how that goes. We've actually been doing character building exercises with Heavens and Heresies every other Wednesday for a little over a month now. Mm-hmm. And just random race, one of the classes and its subclass. And the subclasses in Heavens and Heresies are also really important. They flavor your character into a specific gameplay style. And then, of course, a different upbringing, or a different upbringing and background as well. Mm-hmm. And it all ties together in character creation very, very intricately and intimately. It's very much every piece of character creation affects every other piece of character creation, and they're all very much connected and affect how your character is going to go all the way to 20th. Mm-hmm. As a side note, I did tell Tanner that I had chilled Heavens and Heresies to you, Mark, and that I had specifically told you about raising the death flag. And he said, "That is very much appreciated. Awesome. More people should have the death flag mechanic. It makes deaths more epic while still ensuring they happen."
Yeah, yeah.
So,
and it makes players maybe even want to die, right? Because they get to go out so heroically.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I can guarantee that there are people during the playtests for Heavens and Heresies that have picked their class based on its death flag mechanic. But so the fact that your birthrights also play into giving you edges and equipment and other advantages throughout the game, rather than just here's what you get at start, go have some fun, again, really appreciated, because if you have that, like you said, if you have that as a mechanic, you're picking this as part of your character that you're building rather than as just a way to flavor your character, it should definitely be more effective than beyond level 3.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think that's definitely also how we've designed like the edges and the disciplines, is that when you design powers so that you have a role, and the role is based in our case on your ability bonus and your skill bonus, the dots. Mm-hmm. That means as you have more and more dots, as you get more powerful, those powers change in like what you're capable of doing and how you can do them. So it has a real, very real feel. So things feel more significant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know?
And that I think is a great way to design powers. And I think that's how we did our edges, especially for the birthrights, is so that, you know, as you get more and more dots, like this power, the texture of it changes. So it's not just, oh, you get an extra D4 of damage. No, you can affect more different kinds of things with this edge.
Mm-hmm. A question I did have regarding some of the starting edges. I noticed that when it came to something like your background, your estate, I believe it was called, they were all generally the same. It's you are of this estate and you get boon on all social and mental roles involving that same estate. So people of the same background as yourself, you have an advantage with.
Big time.
And I was wondering, I know because this is just a playtest document, we have some truncated information. I was wondering if estates or backgrounds get any more types of edges, or if this was a way to not only give you that advantage with other people of like background, but also give you a narrative tie-in, because we here really appreciate a mechanic that also has a narrative tie-in. So
yeah. I mean, this is meant to be like, there's 10 estates, so that means that no matter how big your gaming group is, right, like you won't hit every estate. Right, and so that means that there'll be some estates where they're just going to be hostile to you, but like every player has one estate where you have this huge advantage, where every single social role you get an advantage, you get a boon on, which is an advantage, you know, and D&D turns. So it's a big deal, and we used to actually have for the estates, we used to have a different power for each one, and basically at one point I went, you know what, this is just too complicated. Let's just make it simple but powerful. And I think that this does it in a beautiful way. It sort of gives you with your own social group, you have this huge advantage. You have this this tie-in, and they're your people. Mm-hmm. You know? They may not like you, but they're your people, and they're going to give you the time of day, whereas they won't give someone else. It also is interesting because then, you know, you would think, right, in this game that, oh, if you're a royal, why wouldn't I just automatically take the royal estate because you're royal? Well, yeah, sure, but, you know, if you're a royal from a faraway kingdom and you're trying to hang out with the Vileborn or the outcasts or the outlaws, they're not going to give you the time of day.
They may even try to skin you for your nice coat.
Yeah, like, they don't care. Like, what matters to them is someone from their estate is hanging out. That's who they'll talk to. Of any other estate? No. And so it makes picking out your estates as your group, you know, very important. And having a variety of estates is very important. Mm-hmm.
I think that actually follows some of our own design ethos, Monk, that if something gets too finicky, we just cut it out and replace it with something simple but powerful.
Yes.
So I really like that great minds do think alike sometimes.
Yeah, and that is a key thing that is very hard to control with a D&D type game, is that players want more and more powers, but powers tend to get in the way of creativity and expression, and they take up too much room, and it's too much reading, they make the game too complicated, and then worst of all, they slow everything down. So you always want to figure a way out to have simple powers that are real, but not too varied and not too complex and definitely not too long to read.
Mm-hmm. Which incidentally is the reason why I've picked on D&D's spell design in one form or another for quite a while, putting aside the fact that it ends up muddying what sort of fantasy it's supposed to be. Because if it's supposed to be, say, sword and sorcery, why is it that you can sneeze and find magic items, for one? But also, if there's not a setting, why is it that so many spells are named after people? It's one of those shit or get off the pot kind of things, and that's the reason why I appreciate that with Badlander, even though it's going for a specific style of fantasy, so that question isn't as much of an issue. But one thing I was curious about, if this is something that's planned, is in regard to anchors. Now, I like the mechanic of anchors, but an issue that I've had with plenty of games that have that have this sort of narrative tag, as I've called it as a catch-all, is giving proper guidance. This was a big problem that I had with, say, Fate. I've had this problem with every single Fate game I've ever run or gone through, which is not providing good guidance on what would make a good or a bad example. I recently reviewed a Italian game called Not the End, which goes out of its way to give examples on its particular tags for its Hexis system. And I'm curious if in the full book you'd be giving a few examples or guidance on what would be a good or bad example of an anchor.
Yeah, I mean, we go into depth in the Tailspinner guide. We talk about how anchors can become relica. So at an early level, you're given this anchor. You know, your grandmother gives you this old, you know, cap. Your grandfather had this cap, you know, and I want you to have it too. And it's just an anchor, an emotional connection to your past. But then later on, it could turn out this is a relica. And so instead of, you know, and then you could add powers to it. So instead of having, you know, this weird collection of magic items, you have this one relica that keeps becoming more and more powerful as your anchor and something more and more relevant to your life. So I think that's where we sort of have a different... We're trying to go a different way than your most role-playing games, where you know you're not like this walking in, you know, pocket knife, you know, with all these different attachments and knives.
I think the word you're looking for is Swiss Army knife.
Yeah, Swiss Army knife of you don't want your character to be a Swiss Army knife of magic items, right? Mm-hmm. And so the anchor is a way to try to avoid that.
And that I find that interesting because because Zan and I have had discussion about that kind of thing, where I half jokingly said at one point that the crux of how I see magic item or relic or artifact philosophy is to look at say Conan in the John Milius film. The only magic item, quote unquote, that he has is the Atlantean sword with the writing "Suffer no guilt, ye who wield this in the name of Crom." But it is a sword that is made of far stronger steel than any other sword that you would find. But it's not like he has a bunch of talismans and is armed with a bunch of magic defenses or anything like that. You look at, say, the Master Sword in all of the Legend of Zelda games. It's less about what powers it has and more about the presence and the legend of that thing. It's not just any old sword. It's the Sword of Evil's Bane, the one that is always wielded by the Hero of Time.
Yes, it's an anchor more than anything else, basically.
and it has unique attributes. Sorry, one second. Yeah. It has unique attributes. Mm-hmm. Based on it having this mythological meaning rather than it just having this power. You know, and just a bunch of stuff with powers doesn't really hack it storytelling-wise, in my opinion. But hey, we have to wrap it up. They're calling me back inside. I'm not sure what's going on, but they're rather emphatic.
No worries, man. When it comes to Badlander, unless I'm mistaken, you're shooting for sometime next year for the proper launch so that people can get it in their hands.
Oh no, September.
Oh. That's a heck.
We have a fast iteration strategy. If you order it, you more than likely, unless the printer screws up, you'll more than likely get hold of it by the end of September.
Mm-hmm.
The product is already at the printers right now. Mm-hmm. Isn't that crazy? But that's actually where it's at the printers.
Mm-hmm. But I know you got to get going, and I don't want you to have a sleep on the couch moment on our account. But thank you for being open to coming back. And
it was a fun talk as always.
Mm-hmm. Good.
All I got to say once again, Mark, thank you for creating so many games that, or at least helping to create so many games that shaped my TTRPG obsession. Really,
problem. Thank you.
It's surreal to talk with you, man, and I love the fact that you're still working around making good shit, man. It's fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Appreciate it. Yep.
So until next we meet, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, my name is Mildra. I am your gaming monk. Stay fucking.